Books on Tape presents A Sudden Country by Karen Fisher, read by Cassandra Campbell. Part 1. So we see that sorrow may be good or bad according to the several results it produces in us. And indeed there are more bad than good results arising from it, for the only good ones are mercy and repentance, whereas there are six evil results, namely, anguish, sloth, indignation, jealousy, envy, and impatience. The wise man says that sorrow hath killed many, and there is no profit therein, and that because for the two good streams which flow from the spring of sadness, there are these six which are downright evil. Saint Francis de Sales, On Sadness and Sorrow. There alone. He carried his girl tied to his front, the trap sack on his back, the rifle balanced like a yoke along his shoulders. He walked all day on snowshoes, lost in effort, in steady breathing. The snow drove thick and clotted on his eyebrows, filled his beard. It cluttered his drawing breath. He'd left the cabin, his valley with its knoll of pines. In the barn, the wind had pulled the uneaten hay and scattered it. He'd left the saddles, stiff with frost. The horses had run off. There had been a pass to climb, a north wind to bear against. He'd thought to catch the clearing weather, though each night the moon grew smaller.
Are you there, June?
He made halt with his back to the wind, took off his mittens, blew on his hands to thaw them. She stirred in the bundled blanket.
Let me see.
Her hands emerged. MacLaren tried to feel them, but his own hands were too cold.
All right.
She nodded. She'd cried the night before, a sad, thin wail against him in the stinging wind. He kept looking at her fingers, held them balled inside his hand. He squinted at the sky. In all the world now was nothing but the two of them, and white. At midday, he unlaced his snowshoes, stood them on their tails, knocked the ice out of his beard, lit a fire, stripped balsam boughs for tea. The snow had quit. When water boiled, she took the blanket from him, held it tented as he'd shown her, so she could breathe the clearing steam. Her hair was damp, eyes murky gray like his. He watched her fingers curl around coarse wool. He put the steaming pot beside her. All his life, he'd only gone from one thing to the next, only done what needed doing. His world had all been wood and water, fire, food. It had all been journeys needing made, trap lines to set, a world of things to mend and mind with never time enough. But these past few weeks had taught a different kind of seeing. It was as though such endless diligence had muffled him somehow. But here now were the curled edges of his daughter's ermine scarf, and he could see the hairs stir in the wind, and could see each crack and split in her small lips. He had learned, in these past weeks, the shapes of her knees, her feet, had seen her secret skin. He knew the hard black scabs of scars she would come to live with, if he could command it. She looked at him. "You are mine," he thought. With his eyes again, he saved her. She began to cough. He waited, fed the fire. The wind came up and sprang the pines and showered them with snow. He came off the forest slopes into the river valley in a waning daylight moon. It took less strength to plod along than to see what shelter he could find, what fuel to make a fire. everything was frozen, and he'd worked like this in winter his whole life, but always in the company of men. It was terrible to stop, to see how small she lay without him, waiting for some warmth. At last, in a cove of pines, he trod the snow and floored the camp in boughs, made rough shelter, hacked down limbs and shook them. He put the meat to boil and listened to her breathing. He closed his eyes and waited. One morning after he had made the graves, he'd stood and watched the wind blow down the snow, watched it spill off the laden pines, drift glittering through the blue, each joint and twig of aspen lined in snow, a fairy open work of black and white. It hardly seemed the world should be so beautiful. He'd walked out past the barn and seen on all the stumps and posts and rails a dazzling crest. A herd of elk was feeding off his snowy hay, yarded up, content as horses. He'd shot a cow, cut the meat to carry. He woke to the stink of his blanket burning. She was curled against him, her hand inside his coat. Until these recent weeks, it was always Lisa she'd clung to. He'd never known this kind of flattery, or what it was to be a source of comfort. Now he heard the rattle in her lungs, like glue. He'd come to think he could refuse to sleep, that a man could stay awake. When Lizpat went, he'd been sleeping. Lizpat. Elizabeth. Her lanky legs, sly eyes, the cheekbones like her mother's. She'd raged at the last for scissors, as though she might still cut some figure out of paper. She was 10. He'd had the fever himself by then and was tired. "Go to sleep," he'd said, and left her, not believing any child of his could die so easily. He remembered the dry grief cracking out. He'd stood in the doorway's glare, panic-stripped and heaving. The ground was hard. He'd had no strength to bury her. He kept her for 2 days inside, then hauled her onto the ridgepole for fear of wolves. He came to fear his own sleep after that as well, for the losing of his other two. He stayed awake. He talked to them, tried to cool their faces, keep the chill away. The fire he would keep alive. 5 days of fever turned to chill, engorgement of the flesh, suppuration. All his life he'd worked with men who had survived, seen women scarred, seen children blinded or made deaf. But now they own that horror. Variola. Agony, exact and ineffaceable, every surface real, remembered, the eyes, the tongue, the palms that closed around the cup, the soles on which he walked. His lungs shot through as though he had breathed lie, and no one in 100 miles to know it. "Tota," June would call as he was dozing. Alexander suffered it 10 days, his golden child boy of 2. Blessed release. He remembered carrying him outside, how the bright cold hit them. In the snow against the cabin wall, his legs had given out. He remembered sinking with his boy in his arms, waking sometime later. Remembered the horror of the snow, which had fallen while they slept, and lay unmelted in those curling palms. So he and June, his middle child, were left. Still burning, each breath disturbed what only begged for peace. Each effort broke what little surface might be healing. But he tried to answer when she called. He lay festering in his robes and moaned and would have been glad for death, but for the nightmare fear that she'd be left alone. He would not die and leave her there alone. So he stayed, insensible of days and nights, or that the horses had run off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.